Good morning. I'm Johanna Derlega, publisher of The Hill. I'd like to welcome you to this morning's discussion, The Value of a Cure, Ensuring Access and Encouraging Innovation. I'd like to thank our sponsor, USC Schaefer Center for Health Policy and Economics, for making the event this morning possible. Innovations in medical research and technology have led to cures and breakthrough therapies that are overcoming diseases that were once considered fatal. But are these cutting-edge cures and treatments reaching all communities? How can we balance the high cost of drug development with affordability? And what can we do to ensure that new cures continue to be developed? This morning, we will hear from lawmakers, medical experts, patient advocates, and health industry leaders on these questions. Before we get started, just a few notes of housekeeping. First, in addition to those of you in the studio, we are going to be live streaming on thehill.com. We ask that you keep your phones on silent, but encourage you to join the discussion on social media. You can follow us on Twitter, at The Hill Events, and you can also comment using the hashtag #ValueOfACure. We begin this conversation with two members of Congress who care very deeply about issues related to innovation and access in our healthcare ecosystem. They also happen to be the minds behind the 21st Century Cures legislation that was signed into law last year. And although they sit on opposite sides of the aisle, they are good friends. Please welcome Congressman Fred Upton, the former chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, and Congresswoman Diana DeGette, member of the House Energy and Commerce Committee. Joining them is my colleague, The Hill's editor-in-chief, Bob Cusack. Bob, over to you.
Thank you, and thank you for coming this morning. I want to start off by looking back a little bit. You guys worked together for a long time on the 21st Century Cures Act, and despite this town really being gripped by gridlock over the last several years, how did you get it done? And Congressman Fred, as you said back on stage, can you tell us a story that really shows how you overcame the odds?
Well, we did work hard. We worked very hard for 3 years, and I got a lot of stories, so I don't know, you know, we can keep us here to the Q&A for sure. But
it's a mixed audience.
Yeah. You know, as chairman, I really wanted to work with both sides of the aisle. We have a great committee and so much jurisdiction, and I went to Diana early on, and I said, you know, this is going to be a long literally, it was a three-year effort. I said, I'd like you to partner with me. And we went to each other's districts. We had a lot of funny stories we won't get into at the moment. But we bonded, our spouses bonded. We did things in each other's districts. But we had a driving force, and that was the patients. You know, at the end, there was every reason to delay things. Oh, let's just make this a little better. Oh, let's just put in drug pricing or do a little more money or, you know, whatever it might be. And we just said, you know what? We just can't wait. We can't let this spring into 2017 because that, who knows if you know, what the semblance was going to be. No one really figured Trump was going to win at the end, but you got a whole different political dynamic. But you couldn't wait because it'd be another 2 years. And we had a way, what really helped us was that we actually had a way where we'd have the money available in this fiscal year 17. And that brought in the Obama administration and others to really get it done. And the other thing is, just quickly, Francis Collins. Mm-hmm. There's not a better guy. He brought everybody together. We had a couple of dinners with him, and he was really, there was one dinner, and he goes, oh, Francis Collins, unleashed, I'm ready to go. And it was really terrific.
What was the key, Congresswoman, to really get over the hump? I mean, it came down to the wire at the end of last year, and some people were predicting that it just wasn't going to happen.
Well, I mean, disease doesn't just strike Democrats or Republicans. It impacts everybody. And that's why Fred and I decided that we had to work together with everybody for the 3 years that we did it. And there were so many hundreds of hours of work by Republicans and Democrats, by advocacy groups, by the researchers themselves and the agencies. And of course, the House had passed the bill a year earlier. And then it went over to the Senate. And the Senate, they had some other things they were working on, and drifted on, we were really quite worried that if it went into the election year that it would be a problem. And so I got to give Fred and his staff a lot of credit for coming up with a process by which we could pass it, where we took a bill that had already passed the Senate, where we sort of did a pre-conference report, where we had the House and Senate, Democrats and Republicans, and the White House and agencies at the table negotiating and agreeing on all the language, so that when we got that together, then we would be able to repass that in the House and send it to the Senate. I will say, I'm not going to minimize the high wire act that we had to go on those last few weeks. And in the end, we had such a small window. It was, of course, the end of football season, so I said it was sort of like a 56-yard field goal into the wind at the end.
But the better analogy, Diana, is anyone knows anything about me at sports. And for about 6 months out, I said, you know, it's like the Cubs. Our saying was, it's going to happen. It may take 200 years, but it's going to happen. And it did.
Were you both under pressure from members of your party not to work with one another?
No. I got to say, I credit our leadership on both sides.
Okay.
Well,
Pelosi and Hoyer were terrific. Mm-hmm. Boehner and Ryan and Kevin McCarthy and Steve Scalise. I mean, they were just outstanding.
And on the Senate,
Lamar Alexander
and Patty Murray. Yeah. But I will say, we weren't under pressure not to work with each other, because we just sort of started working with each other and we brought everybody in. Mm-hmm. But in the end, we had pressure from advocacy groups on both sides of the spectrum. People wanted certain things in the bill, they wanted certain things out of the bill, and that was really where a lot of that sausage got made at the end.
Fred, where does it go now? Implementation, what are you watching? Obviously, you pass a law, but that's only really the beginning.
Well, a couple things. As I said, we did get the money in this fiscal year, mm-hmm. and we worked very carefully with the White House, did a table, you know, year by year, over 10 years. We created a new system for offsets, paying for the expenditures that met the smell test in terms of what we wanted to do. So what are we doing now? A couple big things, obviously, with the new Trump administration. Don't have an answer yet, but both of us are working in a bipartisan way again. First of all, hiring freeze.
Right.
Yeah.
We've done a letter,
right.
House and Senate. I know that our leadership has weighed in as well, at least Greg Walden has. And, you know, part of what we did was we said, look, the FDA, we're requiring them to do more. That's the only way to expedite the approval of these drugs and devices. And early on, Peggy Hamburg and then her successor, Kale, said, all right, we want $500 million. I think they just put that number up not knowing that we'd actually give it to them. And we did. Mm-hmm. And so they can't have a hiring freeze because we need more bodies to get these devices and products to market. We also need to know they can't have, you know, we haven't seen the budget yet, the line by line. But again, giving them more resources, remember, we paid for it. There's $500 million more coming into the system, and we don't want a freeze or a cut in the FDA budget, mm-hmm. because otherwise they'll just rob us for what we picked as a priority that passed in the House with 390-some votes.
I see you sent that letter. You've not gotten a response.
We've not heard a response. I asked yesterday, and remember, yesterday is the first day back from 10-day break, so we've not had a response back yet.
To put a finer point on it, if you don't have the staffing and resources at the FDA to actually do the drug and device approval process, mm-hmm. then it doesn't really help you if you come up with the most fantastic new cures with the NIH money that we've gotten. That's why the FDA is just so critical.
It was just one more piece in the puzzle that we was going to help deliver the end result.
Do you think it'll be helpful that a former colleague is now heading HHS for the implementation of the cures?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Tom Price is a brilliant guy. Mm-hmm. Under anyone, you know, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, he'll do well. Got to remember, he wasn't with us when we first passed the bill. He was not with us because, as chairman of the budget committee, he didn't like the mechanism that we use. So we had to change that for the offsets, in essence, mandatory spending side of things. So we worked with him, we changed that for the second round, which then did the trick. But he was, he's a doctor, he's a U of M guy. So he cares a lot about research and finding the cures. I mean, he, Dr. Collins Francis was a professor at Michigan. I mean, a long history, Dr. Salk and others. So it's, I think he'll do well with us.
What do you see 10 years down the road? What will this new law do if there's funding and not hiring freezes and that kind of thing?
Well, if you look at a lot of the initiatives in the bill, the moonshot, the Beau Biden moonshot initiative, $1.8 billion, the precision medicine and the brain initiatives, roughly $1 billion each, and all of the other structuring that we had of expediting clinical trials and making sure that we could do breakthrough therapies for devices and so on. I really hope that we find some great breakthroughs with some of the diseases for which we don't have cures, cancer, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, diabetes, some of those. That was really our hope in putting this very large bill together. In one of the first meetings that we had with Dr. Collins, Dr. Collins said to me, we need to make sure that some of the barriers that have been put in front of our scientists are removed, like letting them go to conferences. And I said, Francis, if that's all we do, we will have failed. We really need to look much more broadly at the way we do biomedical research and how we can adapt it to 21st century techniques and discoveries. And we both, I think, feel really proud that we've achieved that goal.
You know, the other thing that we learned that, again, we brought everybody in. We didn't have a bill and said, we're going to shape everything. We're going to listen to as many people as we can. And so we learned that by a 50% margin reduction, venture capitalists were beginning to invest overseas because they just weren't getting the approvals here. Of course, that means jobs at the end of the day as well. And so I can remember, so my district, Pfizer's my largest employer, largest facility I think in the world is in Kalamazoo. Stryker started there, Homer Stryker started a major device manufacturer in Kalamazoo as well. And about 8 years ago or so, I was going through a new Stryker facility, a new, 800,000 square feet, I mean massive. And I walked in with the then chairman and I said, what do you think, Steve? He goes, I just wonder if we should have built this in China. That was and they have operations there too. So wouldn't you know, in December, Stryker announced they're building a new $110 million facility in Kalamazoo. I don't think that was a direct result of what we did, but by getting these approvals here, we're going to keep the jobs here. And that corridor of research is going to be big. And it's going to, or huge, that's the new word now, right? It's going to be huge.
That's your new word.
Yeah, my new word. Yeah. But it's going to mean jobs, it's going to mean more investment. So as we look back, 10 years from now, looking back, it's going to be great. It really is going to be something else. But the most important thing is we've already seen some really good changes. So as an example, in January, last month, the NCI, National Cancer Institute, already promulgated new regulations. Again, that's something else we have to look at, too.
Yeah.
Regulations, a freeze, got to cancel, too, for every one new one you get. But a new regulation on regulating the formulary of cancer drugs, which they said in their release, it was in the Washington Post on, page 3, big story, is going to mean finding, I think, 130 different drugs and finding, cures for cancer months and months, if not years earlier. As a direct result of what we did. Those are the positive changes that we're going to look back at in the future.
I just wanted to tell the audience that we are going to have questions for the last 10 minutes. So if you think of some questions, and then we'll have mics for this last 10 minutes of the discussion. Congresswoman, I want to ask you, there's a speech tonight. I don't know if you've heard.
It's kind of big.
What do you think? What is the mood, House Democrats? More than 60 House Democrats boycotted inauguration. Is it going to be different tonight than it was under George W. Bush?
We view ourselves as the loyal opposition. We view ourselves as the voice of, frankly, of the majority of Americans mm-hmm. who are concerned about keeping their health care, who are concerned about little things like freedom of the press and other issues in this country. We are very resolved to take on that role, and we think it's a very important role for us to take. There are some things that the new president has talked about that we think we could work together on and with our Republican colleagues in Congress, infrastructure development, other issues like that. I've got to say, based on the events of the last month, mm-hmm. I don't think any of us can give any wild prediction of what might happen tonight. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I can't really say how we're going to react, but we are going to show up with an open mind and, you know, ready to work in a bipartisan way. I think we showed that we can do that with 21st Century Cures.
What are you expecting from the speech tonight?
Well, I don't know. I don't know is the answer. I'm hoping that he does reach out. They said, look, we have enormous problems in our country. We know that we do. And this is a chance for us to work together. I remember Bush. Remember, I worked in the Reagan White House a long time ago. But I remember Bush 41 literally sticking his hand out and saying, I want to work with the other side to get things done. So infrastructure, and I now chair the Energy Subcommittee. We are fully intending to have an energy title within that infrastructure bill, protecting our grid. I mean, looking at a whole number of different things. I know that we can work together on that. National defense is a bipartisan issue. Mm-hmm. We've got a lot of people, a lot of veterans on both sides of the aisle. So I'm hoping that, you know, we can sort of reset things here a little bit. We don't have his budget yet. Remember, he just got his budget director sworn in a week or so ago. So we're behind the curve in terms of timing. Mm-hmm. Not all the cabinet is in. You got 1,200 some positions that have to be confirmed. So, you know, it's just taking him a little while to get started again. But I'm hoping that this is an opportunity that he takes advantage of, where we can show what we did on cures, you know, what we ought to do with the rest of the process.
Your party appears divided on repealing and replacing Obamacare. There's so many obstacles that have to be overcome to pass a bill, whether it's the taxes, Medicaid expansion. What do you think is going to happen? And the speaker has said March is Obamacare month.
Yeah, it's going. And March is tomorrow.
It is.
It is complicated, as the president confessed yesterday. For I am.
Who knew? Who knew?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, who knew? We did. We did. Let me tell you. You know, there's a lot of different factors. There's a lot of different factions, and people staked out where they are.
And that's just within his party.
Yeah. So whether it's repair, as Lamar Alexander, I think, has said, or replace, or, you know, just repeal, I mean, you got a lot of buckets of different colleagues and where they are, and somehow we'll see how it all comes together. Now, let me just say what I've been working on, mm-hmm. particularly the last couple weeks. My governor, Rick Snyder, and I'm looking forward to talking with him this week. He's been here over the weekend. I think he might have gone back yesterday. I'm not sure. We're one of those 31 states that expanded Medicaid eligibility. 31 states, more than 600,000 Michiganders in that window between 100 and 138% of the poverty level that now are able to take advantage of Medicaid coverage. There has to be a way that states like mine, whether you're Republican governor or not, have a way to work with those folks that are within that segment. And I hope that we're getting close to that. You know, we actually have a Republican conference that's starting in about 10 minutes, and we're gonna hear about that the rest of the week. But we'll see where this debate and talk evolves and where it takes us. But to me, that has to. I'm one of those that believes that we should not repeal this without knowing what the replacement piece looks like. Trust us, we'll get it right in 3 years. No. We need to know what it is in advance, and that Medicaid component, particularly for states like mine in Ohio and New Jersey and Arizona and, you know, 25 others, really we know what that landing pad looks like. And that's what's going to be difficult as we try to work together. And, you know, as much as I'd like to think that we're going to get Democratic support, we probably aren't. But it's not working the way that it was, maybe it was intended to. And it needs a lot of constructive input. And I'd like to think that we could do a number of things together, but I know that it'll be difficult.
Well, let me give you my perspective. Mm-hmm. My perspective is that we have now 20 million more people who have health insurance who didn't have health insurance before, including the people in Michigan and Colorado and other states who are on the Medicaid expansion. And what the Democrats have said, I mean, we had like 65 votes to repeal and replace. We're a little bemused, confused, that the Republicans who voted all these times to repeal and replace actually didn't have a plan and still don't have a plan that's going to give those assurances to the 20 million people. I think I told you, Fred, and I've told many of my Republican colleagues, we are eager to help on improving the Affordable Care Act because we do think that there are issues that can really be improved on, making the exchanges more robust and competitive, helping people who have these very high deductibles, and so on. But if you enact legislation that will either make health insurance worse for all of the people who have it now plus others, or actually cut people out of insurance, then obviously that's not going to be a positive result. So what the Democrats have done, I've been talking to a lot of Republicans and Democrats on my committee. I've been talking to some of our Senate colleagues who Fred and I work so closely with on cures, and I actually do think that there's a sweet spot. I do think we could bring a bipartisan group together to really target some of these issues that need to be improved. But as I and all of my other Democratic colleagues who work in the healthcare space have very clearly said, if you are insisting on repealing the Affordable Care Act, you're not going to get any help from us. If you want to do what you, Fred, are saying and others, to say, well, let's improve it, let's figure out how to make it better, let's put a group together, I think that that's going to have the best result for everywhere. I understand the Republicans have a political problem because they did say over and over again for 8 years or whatever that they were going to repeal
ten,
it.
10 years.
Well, but however long it was, so you said you're going to repeal it. We're not going to participate in that process. But if there's a process that says we're going to try to figure out how to make it work for everybody, I think we could do that in the same way that we did 21st century cures. And our doors are open.
Yeah, I like that. You know, there is a sweet spot there. Can we get there? I don't know. Because we've got some on my side that, you know, a spoonful of sugar in your coffee. Man, if there's one grain in there that might be confused as Obamacare light, can't touch it. I mean, it is hard to figure out how you get to 218.
Well, you're not going to pass a bill like this without Democrats and Republicans.
Right, yep.
You can't do it just within the Republican Party, even in the House.
I agree.
Congresswoman, we've seen the town hall protests that Obamacare helped politically Republicans win the House and later the Senate. Are you sensing there's a shift in the politics of the Affordable Care Act?
Let me put it this way. I've had three events since the new president was sworn in. Mm-hmm. One was a rally in support of the Affordable Care Act. We expected 200 people at that rally, and we had 500 people show up. They had to stand outside in the snow, and mm-hmm. they were happy to be there. Mm-hmm. Then I had a listening session about people to come and talk about how the Affordable Care Act has affected their lives. And again, we thought we'd have about 50 people there. 200 people showed up and told us their stories. And sort of the capper for me was a couple of weeks ago, I do these community forums. They're like a town hall meeting. Normally I get 50 or 60 people there. I had 1,000 people show up at my community forum, and virtually all of them wanted to talk about the ACA. What it is people who were sort of complacent before, who are getting, whether it's whether it's the benefits that everybody gets, people with pre-existing conditions, or people hitting their annual lifetime caps, people like that, or if it's people on the Medicaid expansion, or if it's senior citizens whose pharmaceuticals are more affordable because the donut hole was closed, they are all now suddenly realizing they could lose this, and they're mad. And I think that members of Congress, Democrats and Republicans, are seeing this across the country. People who are finally getting health insurance are now really afraid they're going to lose it. And that's why I think, you know, the time is really ripe for us to sit down in a bipartisan way and figure out how to improve it, not to eliminate it. And I think that, you see these TV, the TV news coverage of angry people showing up at town hall meetings. And some of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle have said, well, it's just paid agitators. That's the same. It's not paid agitators. It's like your constituents, right?
Yeah.
But in addition, that's the same thing. That's the same mistake the Democrats made when the Tea Party started up, saying, oh, it's just paid agitators. Mm-hmm. And we lost the House in 2010, and it just went from there. So I think this is a fair warning to politicians on both sides of the aisle. People need to have affordable health insurance that actually gives them the health care access that they need.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to open it up for questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand. We have microphones. And if you can also identify yourself here in the front.
So my name is Kelly Anderson. I work at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, but I'm here in my capacity as a rare disease patient. So today is World Rare Disease Day, so I'd be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to ask a question. So there's about 7,000 rare diseases out there. 30 million Americans live with them, and only 95% have FDA-approved treatments, which forces a lot of patients to use medicines off-label. So there was a lot of good stuff in the 21st Century Cures Act to help some rare disease issues in terms of like the pediatric voucher review and a couple of other things. But I just wanted to know, what more are you guys doing on the Hill to help, fund these cures for rare disease patients like myself?
Well, the NIH, there's, almost $5 billion directly for the NIH, and we had other things that were included for opioids and the like. But I think, as we talk to our rare disease community, and it's amazing, as one gets first on the health subcommittee, as I did, and you start hearing about these, and you really begin to connect with people that have, particularly children, but other diseases, and you get to really know a little bit about them in the research. It really tugs at your heart, and that's one of the things that drove us. It's that patient base that said, we've got to do this, because otherwise there really is no hope. I met with a Duchenne, they were on the Hill 2 weeks ago, the last week before we broke, and when I first came here, a lot of Duchenne kids didn't live past 13 or 14, and now they're in their 20s. We know people that with cystic fibrosis, and again, that was, you lose 15% of your lung capacity every year, and you're not going to live past 25. All of a sudden, got new drugs on the market. I mean, there's real hope, and it'll be, this bill's going to help big time.
We'd like to look at some more things that we can do with drug access and availability, and we think some of that can happen as we look at the reauthorization of PDUFA, which is happening as we
speak. And the use now of biomarkers, which we're going to see, so that we can actually track people and see. Was it an event last week in Grand Rapids? And it's going to be terrific in terms of the lead up in terms of finding a real cure for these things.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm John Rother with the National Coalition on Healthcare. First of all, congratulations on the legislative success, both the process and the outcome. But I want to focus on the word value. And I wonder if there is a way that we could actually evaluate the value of the new innovations that hopefully will be the result of this legislation. But I look at the situation now, we don't even know what the real price is for drugs. We don't have a system of comparing new drugs with what's currently available. Comparative effectiveness is prohibited for PCORI. And we don't have a system of following people after they take their medication to find out what the result is over time. So it seems to me that we still have some work to do on value, and I'd appreciate any comment.
Yeah, well, you're right. We do still have some work to do on value. We did do some additional post-market review provisions in 21st Century Cures, which should help with some of that tracking. Mm-hmm. But I think we decided against the wishes of some people, frankly, that the issue of drug pricing really was an issue that we had to have a deep and robust debate about, but not in the context of 21st Century Cures when we were trying to pass it like the next month. And so I would hope that we would be able to have a series of really robust hearings in the Energy and Commerce Committee around these issues, because it's important to talk about. If you don't know how drugs are priced or what the effectiveness is, either in the short or long run, then it's really hard to as a policymaker, to make public policy that's sensible.
Yeah, just a quick thing. I agree. I do hope that we have hearings. I think Chairman Walden will be doing that. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is long-term, because we know that we're streamlining the process and, again, keeping all the safety efficacies there. And we work very closely with the FDA former directors. You know, Andy Van Eschenbach was wonderful. He sat down for hours, page by page, with his crew going through the bill. Here's what you got. Here's what you didn't. But ultimately, by getting those drugs and devices to the market earlier means you're going to reduce you put some downward pressure on the cost. But the other thing that we really have to take into account is like Alzheimer's. I mean, it's going to cost Medicare $1 trillion in the year 2050. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, things that we spend that reduce that cost, that we don't, I mean, the impact on the individual as well as the families taking care of them, that's a savings. We got to chalk that up in terms of what we ought to do, and maybe that'll be part of the effort when we reauthorize that. Don't tell, you know, everyone that, you know, ultimately, but when we reauthorize the Cures Act a few years from now, we got to take those savings into account. Wonderful investment.
Got a question way in the back.
Good morning. My name is Sonia Kanzader, and I'm with the O'Neill Institute for National and Global Health Law. But my question is actually related to just my role as a mother, as a parent of a child with a condition, with an eye condition that caused her blindness at the age of 9. We're here. We're talking about cure, and I know that a lot of the focus is related to drug therapies and innovation and research in that realm, but in a situation like my daughter's, her only recourse for treating her condition would be through stem cell therapy. And I'm curious just to maybe get a perspective of what is the thought on the Hill related to that issue, and kind of get maybe a peek in some of the progress related to that, because that, to me, that is part of this conversation. If we're looking at cures, it's not just there's a wide breadth of issues that need to go in when we're looking into expanding innovation for cures and therapies. So well, I'm just curious.
As you might know, I was the author of the stem cell legislation with Congressman Mike Castle, which Fred and many of our other colleagues on both sides of the aisle supported. That's the bill that passed the House twice, and I wear it as a badge of honor. It was the first and second vetoes of President Bush. He got a little more free with the veto pen after that, but and then President Obama, as one of his first acts in Congress, entered the executive order expanding ethical embryonic stem cell research, and the NIH adopted some very strict guidelines, and that research has been happening since that time. As you probably know, well, I think we have now 2 or 3 clinical trials that are in stage 3 trials right now, including some for treatments for eye diseases that cause blindness. And the anecdotal, even though they're only in stage 3, the anecdotal evidence is that the sight was actually restored in some of those patients. So we're moving along. We've also had exciting breakthroughs in spinal cord injury and in diabetes. I have a daughter who's a type 1 diabetic, so that's of particular interest to me. So there's a lot going on in that space, both with government funds and also with private coalitions working. And we're certainly, and again, this is an issue where it's bicameral, bipartisan. Orrin Hatch was one of my biggest helpers on this bill when it passed. So I think that we really need to make sure that we continue to push this forward. And Fred can also talk about some of the innovations we have in the Cures bill.
We had a very small piece that was bipartisan. We worked, this was one of the last big pieces that fell into place on the regenerative side of things. And we worked, again, it was, we worked closely with the FDA. They helped us with the language. So, you know, as an optimist, as a Cubs fan, I'd like to think that this is going to help people like your daughter big time.
Fortunately, we've run out of time. I want to please thank the two fine members here who worked together. And welcome Johanna back to the stage.